Well, it has been a whirlwind first week for new Prime Minister Anthony Albanese. On Monday morning, he was thrust onto the world stage at a meeting of the Quad in Japan. By Friday, he fulfilled a pre-election promise to allow the Murugappan family to go home to Bilawila. Let's take a look now at those first 7 days under Labor with David Crow, the Chief Political Correspondent for the Sydney Morning Herald, and Karen Middleton, Chief Political Correspondent for the Saturday Paper. Welcome to you both. David, we'll start with you. So far, so good. The first week seemed to go well for Labor, but there is still a lot to do.
There are some enormous challenges for a new government, but you'd have to say it's been a very good opening week for Anthony Albanese. I mean, he was sworn in with an interim government first thing Monday morning. I think one of the fastest transitions into, you know, formally taking the reins that we've ever seen. And that was forced by the global situation and the summit that was scheduled for Tokyo, which he had to go to straight away. So we saw a very quick start, and I think that actually has been good for the government and good for Anthony Albanese. Straight into the job, good meetings overseas. It actually has the impact of sort of raising his stature and cementing his authority as Prime Minister within a day or two of the election. Normally it takes longer than that. Mm. And bear in mind, we think that they're going to get to 76 or 77 seats. That's where they're tracking at the moment. So they'll have a narrow majority, I think. But he was sworn in before that was even clear. And normally we don't see that either. So it was a pretty smooth start, I'd say.
They certainly ended the week on a high, Karen. We saw the Bilawila family being allowed to return. But, you know, but before the election, the previous government didn't want to allow that to happen. They said it would send a message about Australia's position on asylum seekers. We also had that asylum seeker boat well-publicised arrival on election day. How does all this play into the Albanese government's position on this issue, do you think?
Well, it's interesting, isn't it, Jane, that the new government then put those passengers from that boat on a plane and turned them around to Sri Lanka. Now, that'll upset some of their are in the Labor constituency, but it did give them the opportunity to say, see, we have the same border policy, but, and this is where the distinction is, Anthony Albanese is saying, we can be strong on borders, but we don't have to be weak on humanity, and that's the point about the Bilawila family going home. So he's making a clear statement that this will be a kinder government, but it doesn't mean it will be a weaker government. Now, that'll be tested over time. I think it's an interesting start, isn't it? And it does really show that he's taking a different approach to a number of issues, including this.
Correct me if I'm wrong, Karen, but I also don't think anybody so far has criticised that decision.
I haven't heard anybody criticise it. You remember that Barnaby Joyce, the former Deputy Prime Minister, was a big advocate for sending the family home to Bilawila as well. And so he has come out and said it was a great decision. So there hasn't been any public backlash that we've heard yet.
Which is wonderful. David, let's go back to that other issue. You were in Tokyo for the Quad meeting. We saw those pictures of Anthony Albanese with the other world leaders. He was the only one wearing that blue badge so that he would actually be recognised. How did the other world leaders respond to our new PM?
Very well. I mean, it was a very successful meeting in Tokyo for Anthony Albanese. One of the key factors was that he went there with a message on climate change. He's on the same page as Joe Biden, the US president, on climate change. Also, that's a message that was welcomed by Narendra Modi, the Indian Prime Minister, and Fumio Kishida, the Japanese Prime Minister. So that instantly, I think, meant that Anthony Albanese was well received by those leaders. He also had a firm message on China. He said the thing that China's got to do is it's got to end these sanctions on Australian products where we're not able to export into China. So on those fronts, he had a message well received. But I think it was all the optics and the human touch that actually made it such a successful meeting. We saw three times Joe Biden went out of his way to joke in front of the cameras with Anthony Albanese, make it clear to everybody that the US administration was totally happy with the new Labor government in Australia. In that, with that personal touch, I think he was putting to rest any of those ideas about Labor leaders being Manchurian candidates or not being trustworthy on national security. And so I think the optics, as well as the written message, worked very well for the government in that meeting.
I think probably the only real hiccup that they've had this first week was Tanya Plibersek having to apologise for those comments she made about Peter Dutton's appearance. He's likely to be the new Liberal leader. She got slapped down, if you like, by Anthony Albanese fairly quickly, Karen. Do you think that is a sign of how he is going to run his cabinet? He is going to be in charge, making sure everyone stays in line?
Yeah, he needs to make a clear statement, again, that he's not weak, that he's strong, and that goes to, for his own government as well. And his big message has been about respect. Before the election and since, he's saying we respect the public, we want to have a more respectful process, we respect the parliament, and we respect each other. He's got good relationships across the parliament, including with Peter Dutton. In fact, he's made the point he gets on better with Peter Dutton than he did with Scott Morrison. So he doesn't want his own government acting in ways that would contradict that. So he really had to do that and say to Tanya Plibersek, look, you know, you need to apologise for that, because otherwise, you know, you can't say one thing and then have your own ministers doing something different. And he doesn't really want people sledging each other's appearance, men or women. Mm. So, you know, I think it was an important statement to underline this whole message about a more respectful tone and a different way of doing politics.
And Karen, how do you think the now opposition is going to go moving forward? There were some pretty strong comments, shall we say, in your paper this week, in the Saturday paper yesterday, from Liberal MPs about the performance of the outgoing Prime Minister. He's still going to stay there in that party room. Is that going to create instability? Will the new leader have clear air? What do you think?
To be honest, I don't think he'll stay there for all that long. You know, former Prime Ministers usually don't, when they've lost and when they step aside, unless they've got ambitions to come back. And I don't really think that's the case here. So I would think that soon Scott Morrison will go off and do something else. But the Liberal Party's got a huge reckoning now. They've got to sort out what they stand for. I think that's been part of the problem. People don't really know anymore what they stand for. They've got this real division between right and left. They've been gutted at this election. All the moderate MPs have gone. So they're going to have to work out how to appeal to a broad range of the electorate and really move back to the centre. And I think it would be a mistake if they interpret this election result as an endorsement of going to the right, because most of the people in Australia sit in the middle. They want a, you know, even-handed middle ground government and opposition, and they don't want extremes of either side. And I think that the Liberal Party's got a lot of work to do to rebuild itself and present itself next time around as a viable alternative. That's going to be tough because they haven't really got all that many seats now, and there's all these teal independents in the middle that'll make it much harder for the Liberal Party to get back into majority government. They've got work to do, but they're obviously determined to do it. And some of those horrible comments that were in our paper are a sign that there'll be a bit of a thrashing around, I think, and blaming, particularly about that whole individual nature of that campaign, the big focus on Scott Morrison, who turned out to be unpopular, before they can really pull back together and move forward.
We're going to see a lot of chess pieces moved around this week with the leadership of the Liberal Party and the National Party in play, and Anthony Albanese set to announce his new cabinet. So plenty more to talk about next weekend, but thank you both for joining us. Over-